Rubik's Cube. So for those of you that are not capable of solving a Rubik's Cube and want one for your desk, wake up. And again, as we've heard multiple times, Shmoocon, the conference with balls, each of you gets a ball in your bag. We want you to use these not just as a stress toy, but if for some reason you are sitting in a talk, hopefully not this one, but if you're sitting in a talk and you think the speaker is full of crap, let them know. And if you're not willing to stand up and point and say, you, I think you're full of crap, stand up and throw a ball. So, to make sure that there's more, you know, because I know these are a collector's item for some of you, to make sure that you have that opportunity, wake up, I just threw a ball at you. So congratulations for sitting on the front row. You get an extra shmoo ball. Good catch. All right, and we have a t-shirt. Let's see, who is this one from? From Milcorp. And this is a size large. So congratulations. All right, so with that, with all of my announcements taken care of, I would like to please give a warm welcome to a first-time Shmoocon speaker, Rebekah, who will be talking to us about plug-in electric vehicle fingerprinting. So please give her a warm round of applause.
Hello, can everyone hear me? Okay, good. So I don't have a bio slide to give you more about me. I wanted to kind of introduce myself in the context of how the fingerprinting project got started. So wrapping up my first year in the electrical and computer engineering graduate program at the University of Delaware, I also got my bachelor's in electrical engineering at U of D. And after my first semester there, I started working with their electric vehicle degrader EV2G research project. And that project is looking at using electric vehicles as a grid resource. So basically, the team has developed technology both for the vehicles and charging stations to allow vehicles to feed power back into the power grid in response to commands from a controller, and that's for the purpose of providing essentially balancing services for the grid. This picture here is of essentially what we call our mini power plant, which is operated on part of campus for a few years now. It has about 15 charging stations, and most of the time is operated with some vehicles that are just dedicated to being on call by the controller. And in the project, the vehicles are normally the focus of attention, but the charging stations, which are there on the left, are also a critical component. And I'm a little bit biased there because for most of my time with the project, I was the charging station specialist. I was given this title a couple weeks after joining, and it basically meant I was the charging station doctor. So as I said, the team had designed technology for the charging stations even before I joined. And when I joined, we had received shipments of our charging stations from our manufacturing partner, which we were going to then install. So my job was to prep the charging stations in the lab before they were installed. So this is my lab setup, and it's a charging station. I would then often be part of the installation process, normally fixing things I didn't get quite right in the lab, and then sometimes do updates. And it was a good project, and I learned a lot, but it wasn't something that I considered really researchy, i.e. not something that I could maybe one day write a paper on. So I sat down with my research advisor and couple of grad students, and they popcorned some ideas for new projects, and the PEV fingerprinting one was one that stuck out to me. I was fascinated by this idea that I, from the charging station's perspective, could gather more information about the vehicle plugged in than what it made readily available. I felt like I was going to be some kind of a detective, so I jumped into that. And just to give you an idea of the scope of the EV world, at least in the United States, and the number of vehicles or the types that we're trying to look at, according to ChargePoint, which manufactures charging stations and controls a large charging station network, there's over 500,000 electric vehicles on the road in the United States and Canada today, which is consistent with data from AFDC, energy.gov. They just don't have stats up through 2016. And there are over 20 electric vehicle models available. So that was a little bit of intro, now a little more structured background on what we're doing and so forth. So starting with what is electric vehicle fingerprinting? I want to get some definitions out of the way so I can use some terms freely for the rest of the presentation. PEV, or plug-in electric vehicle, for the purposes of this talk, refers to any plug-in hybrid or fully electric vehicle, basically any vehicle with a large battery that plugs into charge. And I'll often shorten this just to EV, electric vehicle. EVSC is all of the hardware dedicated to providing charge to a vehicle. And again, I'll use this term interchangeably with charging station. So this hypothesis is the driving idea behind the fingerprinting project. It's, again, that I, as a charging station, or from the charging station's perspective, can look at the charging behaviors of whatever's plugged in and determine what type of vehicle it is without it having to tell me. Clarifying a couple of terms by type, I'm talking about manufacturer, model, and year. So a 2015 Leaf, as far as I'm concerned, is a different type from a 2013 Nissan Leaf. And charging behavior can refer to a variety of things, such as the way the vehicle draws power at the beginning of a charging session, or characteristics of the signaling that's used to set up a charging session. And I'll go into that in a little more detail later. I find it's helpful to explain what I'm trying to do in context of some similar work in other areas, so operating system fingerprinting and browser fingerprinting are, again, analogous in the way in that they are attempting to identify either specific browsers or a general, more general category operating system just based on settings or flags, information that the fingerprint, the device being fingerprinted makes readily available to the fingerprinter. And these are both what I would consider to be software-defined or digital fingerprints. In some ways, what I'm trying to do would be more what I would call hardware-defined or analog fingerprinting. And again, some similar concepts, and I know there are many, many more, but these are just the ones that I picked out. In 2005, Casey Clancy at UC San Diego and her team showed that you could identify individual machines by measuring their clock skew, again, over the network. And then more recently, in 2013, researchers at Stanford did something similar with mobile devices and data from microphones and accelerometers. So that was what fingerprinting is. Now who cares? There were some motivations thrown out at the beginning of the fingerprinting project that mostly revolved around improving charging, vehicle charging management. So with identifying incompatibilities, this basically looked at the idea that you might have a situation where a vehicle would plug into a charging station and some feature in one or the other would cause them to interact negatively. So for example, when we first started installing our charging stations in 2013, we had an incident where a vehicle that plugged in and had its delay charge feature set, it caused the relay in our charging station that connected the power to the output to start cycling rapidly. It was not a good thing. And as part of the debugging process, we checked with a couple of other vehicles of different types, plugging them in with their delay charge feature set, and they didn't have the same problem. So expanding this a little bit, if you were managing a network of charging stations and you had an error that was occurring repeatedly, if you could, if you knew that it was only happening with a certain type of vehicle, it could facilitate the process of debugging. For real-time charge management, this is the example that I like to use. So if you have an EVSC or a dual-head EVSC that has to split power between two vehicles that are charging, and to explain what I mean by split power, so the charging station will advertise power, or specifically it'll advertise a maximum current available to an EVSC. And the EVSC has to or the vehicle has to limit itself to draw no more than that advertised current. So if the vehicle can't actually, it's not capable of drawing that much, it'll limit itself to what it can do. If it can draw more, then it has to stay within what the charging station has advertised per the standards. So again, if you have a charging station that's sharing power between two vehicles, say it decides the best thing to do is to split the power evenly, there are some vehicles that might not be able to use the full amount advertised, and it's possible one of the vehicles plugged in could use more. So then you end up with one vehicle not charging as fast as it could and another one not using the full amount of power advertised. So if you knew, if the charging station knew at the get-go which type each vehicle was, it could advertise more appropriate amounts of power and let them both charge at their maximum rates. And you could say this example doesn't really hold water because if it's a smart charging station anyway, like it can figure things out, it might notice one vehicle's charging slower, one's charging faster. It can change the amount of power that it advertises at any point during the charge event, so it could just shift things around and see if the other vehicle will start charging faster. You could come up with corner cases where that might work. Bottom line, the fingerprinting is helpful, if maybe not necessary. For grid integration, though, as I said in the beginning, our team with the V2G is looking at doing what we call bidirectional V2G, so the vehicles can actually feed power back to the grid. There are systems where you can still provide balancing services where the controller just tells the vehicle to slow down or stop charging. I understand from other members on the team that these are being implemented in other regions of the world. There's some vehicles, though, if you tell them to stop charging, they don't start again when you're ready for them to come back online. I've seen this happen. I've done it. So if you're going to be doing that kind of management, you want to make sure that the vehicle that you're telling to stop charging isn't one of the types that's not going to come back online when you're ready for it. So I want to address what I consider to be kind of an elephant in the room is, why can't I just ask the vehicle what it is? If it's that important for me to know, every device is talking these days, why can't I just get the information from the vehicle itself? There's a couple of reasons why we wanted to go the route with fingerprinting. The first is that while the vehicle is probably talking to someone somewhere, it may not necessarily be talking to the charging station. The only information that the charging station is guaranteed to get is what comes via the charging cable. And common standards for electric vehicle charging don't specifically support a means for the vehicle to identify itself to the charging station. I think of it like Herbie. If you've seen the movie, Herbie is, he can communicate very effectively using his horn or his lights, but he never talks and he never says his name. Similarly, with the standards, the common standard we're looking at, the vehicle and the charging station can set up a charge session, but there's no identifying information exchanged. So then, just to clarify a little bit here, we're focused on level one and level two charging, which you can think of as like low and moderate charge rates, which are the most commonly used standards or levels in the United States. We had to pick a scope. And the default standard for those is the SAEJ 1772, and that doesn't support the exchange of identifying information. So you can work around this and implement your own specialized communication kind of on top of the standard, which is what our team does with V2G. But it's not, you have to have the same technology in both the charging station and the vehicle. There are also standards that have been developed to support more advanced communication than what the current common standards do, but they're not widely implemented. Even if they were implemented, there's another reason for the fingerprinting in that the vehicle might misidentify itself. You might not want to just rely on what it says it is. This idea of being able to kind of identify that lying was not one of the original motivations. There was nothing to do with security in what we were originally looking at. So this kind of sent me off on a tangent of exploring vehicle security in general, and I want to briefly follow that tangent. So in general, security for vehicles, not just electric vehicles, has two factors. One of those is the fact that cars are more and more just computers on wheels. Components, even critical components like the brakes, are increasingly controlled by embedded systems. The other factor is the connectivity of the vehicle. There are multiple channels for the vehicle to talk to the outside world and vice versa. And different researchers have done some demos of how vehicles can get hacked that have gotten a lot of media attention. Manufacturers are more and more aware, which is good. Less attention has been paid to some of the EV-specific concerns, and these mostly relate to the role that electric vehicles are expected to play in the emerging smart grid. So backing up a little bit, a single electric vehicle can draw normally over 3 kilowatts when it's charging, and that's on par with the average, and from what I've read in different papers, the peak power drawn by a single family residence in the United States. So obviously, if you get a bunch of vehicles plugging in and charging at any point at the same time, you have the potential to overload the grid and damage service equipment. So meeting the demand by electric vehicles as they become more common is a known challenge, and the general consensus is that as electric vehicles become more common, they won't just be allowed to charge free for all. There will be management systems which require communication and control, which are then targets. And there are a couple of interesting papers that talk about this a lot better than I could. And I just wanted to highlight some of the major concerns that they address, put it in terms of CIA. So for confidentiality, anytime you have a vehicle plugging into one of these management systems, you've got authentication, negotiation of how and when the vehicle's going to charge, payment exchange with integrity. Regarding the messages exchanged between a vehicle and the central controller, these messages are used to make sure the vehicle is charged appropriately, like when the owner wants it to be charged and not during the times when power is most expensive, and also that the grid isn't overtaxed, so making sure that those are maintained. And that, again, ties into availability. Even as part of the smart grid, the vehicle is still primarily a transportation device, so it needs to be available when and where the driver wants it. Availability also pertains to the grid itself. So one of my favorite papers that talked about security concerns repeatedly cited the potential for some rather drastic effects if the vehicle didn't play nice and do what the grid asked it to do. So in the context of the needs for security surrounding electric vehicle charging in the future, I'm not entirely sure what role fingerprinting would play. At one point, I thought it would be pretty helpful, but in general, we're trying to make the vehicle less of a black box to the charging station, just give it the charging station or the charging system more tools, with the qualification that we also want to maintain the privacy of the driver. I don't want to be supplying tracking tools for anyone, so disclaimer there. So that's background. Now getting into the fun part of how it works. So this is the interface defined, I got louder, by the SAE J1772, and this is the vehicle side. And these are the connections that I have for fingerprinting. Just starting out, I don't get any information from ground or the proximity detection on the charging station side, which is where I'm measuring my parameters. The proximity is essentially ground. So starting with the control pilot, or pilot for short, this line is used to set up, it's for signaling to set up the charging session. This is a circuit defined by the SAE J1772 standard, and I'll walk through a little bit of circuit analysis in the context of setting up a charging session before I start. The P there in the middle, that's the pilot line connection, and G is ground. So again, looking at the charging station side, because that's where the fingerprinting is happening, before a vehicle plugs in, charging station's all by its lonesome, and it's holding the pilot line at the sampling point to 12 volts. At this point, we say the charging station is in state A, where no vehicle is connected. When a vehicle connects, you see now we have a voltage divider comprised of R1 and R3. That's going to pull the voltage on the pilot line down to 9 volts. Now we're in state B1, where a car has connected, but the charging station has not said that it's ready to provide charge. When the EVSC sees the 9 volts on the pilot line, if it's ready to provide charge, it'll start generating a 1 kilohertz PWM on the pilot line, and that'll range from negative 12 to 9 volts, the two nominal values. At this point, we say we're in state B2, where the charging station has now indicated that it's ready to provide charge. When the EV detects the PWM, if it wants to charge, it will close S2, and now we have a different equivalent resistance between R3 and R2 in parallel, and that will pull the max voltage on the pilot line down to 6 volts. Now the charging station is in state C2, where the vehicle has requested charge. At this point, the charging station should close the contacts to allow power to flow to the vehicle. And again, the state diagram kind of summarizing it all, as well as how we get back out of the different states. Something I didn't mention before, but I said the charging station advertises the max power or current available to the vehicle, and it does that with a duty cycle of the PWM, and there's a chart in the standard that explains how that works. It's not really relevant here, so I won't go into that. So what information can I get from this circuit and the protocol we just walked through for fingerprinting? Well, these resistors here, the 2.7 and 1.3 are nominal values set by the standard, but there is an allowed variance. So if different vehicle types or different manufacturers were using resistors that had slightly different values, that would manifest itself in different voltage levels measured on the pilot line when the vehicle's plugged in. So then in any B state or in state C2, the voltage levels at that point become fingerprinting parameters. There's also an action taken by the EV that we can detect from the EVSC side, and that's the time it takes for the EV to measure or detect the PWM and close S2, which is the time spent in state B2. And again, that becomes one of our fingerprinting parameters. So again, just in terms of the other diagram, this is what we're looking at. And a little bit of a disclaimer here. Our charging stations, the University of Delaware charging stations, which are what I'm using to test, implement a couple of additional states. So as I said, we do specialized communication to be able to implement our V2G systems. And the way we do that is we have additional states. And at the start of the charging session, we test if the vehicle can do our special communication. And with the vehicles we were testing, they couldn't. Intentionally used non-V2G vehicles. So we then go into the normal state progression and our parameters are the same. So that's it for the pilot line. Now looking at what you can get from the power lines. So this is what we expected a generic current profile for an EV would look like when it starts to charge. So once the vehicle is closed, the switch to go into state C2, we expect there's going to be a pause or before the vehicle starts to draw current, so that pause, the time would be T1. And then the vehicle would ramp up to some constant current, or relatively constant current, which we called the final current, or I final. And the time that it took to reach that current would be T2. So again, summarizing the parameters that we're looking for, we have 6 and 3 from the pilot line, 3 from current. In actuality, we couldn't get T1 and T2, and I'll explain later why, but we ended up having to combine them into just one parameter, which was the difference between these two points. Before I go further, I should address which assumptions that I'm making as I'm fingerprinting. First is I'm ignoring battery state of charge. And the reason is, well, at this point we have to assume some things. The vehicle for most states of charge will go into constant current mode up until it gets pretty close to full, at which point the battery management system will start balancing the cells and the current will look a little bit strange. But since most of the vehicles that we'll be plugging into our charging station, we assume are doing so because they actually need to charge, we're assuming they're reaching the same constant current each time they start. With regards to ambient temperature, eventually this is something we'll have to take into account more. Right now the idea is if I can fingerprint a vehicle at a relatively constant range of temperatures, I can eventually express my parameters as a function of temperature and take it into account that way. And finally, with battery state of health, even vehicles of the same type will see different usage, and so this could start to affect the health of the battery, which could affect the parameters that we're observing. So something that just came up recently that I haven't really looked into a whole lot, so just for now, not taking it into account, but being aware of it. So that was how it works in theory, and now what we've done to test it. So we're testing on vehicles either owned by the University of Delaware or by individuals who have allowed us to check their vehicles, and we're using University of Delaware-owned charging stations. We're getting data by repeatedly plugging and unplugging the vehicles. We give them 2 minutes to charge to reach some kind of a steady state, and then we unplug and let them reset for like 2 minutes, and we do that several times. While we're plugging and unplugging the vehicles, the charging station is reporting logs from 3 different components. So the RCD, which controls the relay that connects the power to the vehicle side, reports state and error info. The meter reports information regarding the power, and the VEO board reports information pertaining to the pilot line and the state. And here I'll explain why we can't get T1 and T2 as originally defined. So you might recall it's we wanted to get the time from when we go into state two, or state C2, until something happens on the current line. Well, current information only comes from the meter, which doesn't report state information. As it turns out, we couldn't synchronize the logs between the two or three different devices. We would end up seeing strange things like the charging station was providing current when there was no vehicle plugged in, according to the state logs. So within the logs, there was consistency, but between them, we just couldn't make things match up. So we went with, since we could find with the current, the time between when we reached a steady current to from when we started to draw current, that's what we went with. So we're getting, in the end, information just from the meter and the VEL board, so explaining the hardware a little bit more. We're using EKM OmniV.4 pulse meters, which are off-the-shelf revenue-grade meters that report or can report power up to 800 times per kilowatt hour. What that looks like for us is that we see current samples every 2 to 3 seconds, though I have seen them spaced out as much as 7 seconds. With the VEL board, this is a board designed by our team, and the heart of that is a 16-bit microcontroller. We're using the analog to digital converter module on that, configured for 10-bit resolution to sample the pilot line voltages. And then to get timing, we're using a counter that increments every millisecond, and every time we change state, we grab the value of the counter. So again, all of these components report logs, and those go up to a central server. And then I had to write a bunch of code to pull the logs and put them all together and format them in a way that I could use as input for data mining software. So after all of the plugging and unplugging and pulling the logs, I ended up with 130 charge events, which I define as a time a vehicle plugged in and started charging and charged for at least 2 minutes. And I have 7 vehicle types, and 3 charging stations were used for testing. I want to talk through real quick how I extracted all of the parameters from the logs, which were just CSV files. So again, these are the parameters I was looking at. So starting with pilot line voltage, I started by plotting these to kind of hopefully get an intuition and maybe see some differences. I didn't really see any differences between vehicles, but I was a little concerned about what I was seeing in the states B1 and B2. As you can see, we're not grabbing just like the nominal 9 volts or the negative 12. I'm getting a lot of samples in between, and I assumed this was because there was a PWM being carried on the pilot line at that point, which meant I was probably grabbing the voltage when the pilot line was either rising or falling. So to take care of that as best as I could, I would sample the pilot line. I changed the firmware to sample the pilot line multiple times on a state change. And then in states B0, B1, or B2, the maximum voltage is supposed to be 9 volts. So in a charge event, I would grab all of the pilot line voltage samples for state B0, B1, or B2. I would discard the negative samples and take the median of what was left, and that worked pretty well for finding the nominal voltage. And I would do the same thing basically for C2. Looking at the time spent in state B2, I just looked at the mean, median, and standard deviation. And for most of the vehicles, the standard deviation was pretty small, which was nice. For the I3, it was atrocious. This was basically because all but one of the samples for the I3 were around 300-something milliseconds, and one of them was more like 3,000. So whether that was something wrong with the sampling or whether the I3 actually did something strange, I'm not really sure. So that was it for the pilot line parameter extraction. Again, looking at current parameters, the first thing I did was to plot the different current profiles for the EVs. And this was a little more encouraging than the pilot line because I could see the vehicles were different both in terms of the max final current reached and kind of the ramp they took to reach that current. And I broke out the different curves to see them a little bit better. Here you can see where the assumption about vehicle state of charge kind of doesn't work with the volt. Best as we can tell from the notes we were taking during testing, the volt was getting close to full. The battery was almost full. So every time we plugged it in, it was reaching a different final current. So yeah, we need to fix that. But moving on, bravely and proudly, we got the current, or the final current, using this algorithm. It was kind of something I made up. So basically, I look for every current sample during a charge event where the current was the same for at least 3 consecutive samples, or deviated by less than 2 amps. And I would grab all of those, find the median, and that, again, worked well for finding the final current. And then I would go back through the charge event and look for the first time that median value occurred, basically, and that was my timing parameter. In looking at the current profiles, I noticed that the vehicles also started to charge a little bit differently. There would be a few samples with low current, and then the current would start ramping up relatively rapidly. I decided to make these a couple of new parameters. I called the current where we started to have a more rapid rate of increase the knee current, and the time when it occurred to be T start. And again, built a little algorithm, and basically this is saying that at the start of a charging event, if I have a relatively low amount of change and then all of a sudden I have a sample that deviates from the previous by more than an amp, I'm going to call that my starting or my knee current. This doesn't really work well for capturing that behavior, this particular algorithm, so this is something I have to keep working on. But in any case, once I had all the parameters, I put them in one CSV file and pumped that into Weka data mining software and used that with a couple of classifiers to build models and tried it with using all parameters as input and then just limiting it to the pilot or power parameters only. I got the best performance with using all parameters and, yeah. So I'm no data mining guru, so I don't know the internals of these classifiers. The J48 is nice in that it breaks out its model into this decision tree, so you can see which parameters it's using as differentiating, as major differentiators between vehicles. So the voltage in state C is the major one, and then the current, the final current reached, as well as the voltage in state B were the differentiators that it chose. And again, the confusion matrix is good to look at. So we've got 2011 volt was classified as a 2015 Cmax. Naive Bayes does not generate a nice decision tree for me, and as best as I can explain it, the naive Bayes is probability driven, so things like the mean, the standard deviation, those are important. So that's why this is in here, but I'm not going to go over that. The confusion matrix is a little more intuitive here. We have two vehicles of the same model, just different years that have been, I'm sorry, three different vehicles of the same model but different type that have been confused. So again, just highlighting our results, we've got 99% of the instances were classified correctly using the J48 and 97% using naive Bayes. There are obviously limitations to what we're doing. We only have 130 instances, and to this point we haven't been able to test two vehicles of exactly the same type, which leads us into where we go from here. So first of all, address the assumptions that we've made, as well as some others that I haven't mentioned, not major ones. And additional tests and parameters, so possibly instead of just going through a normal charging sequence or sequence to set up a charging event, maybe I'm introducing some unusual behavior on the charging station side and seeing how the vehicle responds, possibly adding additional parameters. Again, more EVs is most important. And then possibly trying to get better data from our charging stations, so maybe increasing the resolution of our ADC and seeing if there's a way to synchronize the data from our different components. I want to acknowledge my team. And any questions? Yes?
Was there enough variation between vehicles that had the same type that people were able to might have been able to fingerprint individual vehicles within a class?
I haven't had access to two vehicles of the same type that I could test, so I don't at this point know.
So related to that, given enough data, and you mentioned you don't want to basically build tracking, but do you foresee the possibility that you could, based on charge, length, cycle, determine if a vehicle was driven in the same pattern on a daily basis, and then there's a deviation from that pattern, since you can fingerprint the type of vehicle?
So if I understand the question, you're basically saying if I can fingerprint the type of vehicle, I might be able to do tracking just based on patterns of when and how long it charges and where?
Yeah, not just length of charge to get back to state. That would be a good indicator of distance driven. And from Friday is this long, Saturday is this long, and eventually identify individual vehicles using that product data set, which essentially would lead back to your tracking that you don't want to do.
Yeah, that's, I did kind of note the possibility of that when I was starting the project, and I don't know for sure. It is something we are keeping in mind. But yeah. Yes.
So I don't own a Tesla or anything, so I have no basis for this question, but I do know from my experience with a couple of car CPUs that the charge rate and the amount of credit is great. Is there a point essentially a charging unit, the actual charging unit, does it talk to a microprocessor on the car which controls all that behavior in terms of how much it's pulled and that kind of stuff? Is there a corresponding unit on the car that does that?
So if I understood the question, you're asking, is there a microcontroller in the vehicle that the microcontroller in the charging station is talking to? So I don't know how it's done in vehicles in general. In our vehicles, we have a microcontroller that controls the pilot line on the vehicle side. So that's as much as I know. I imagine the only communication between the charging station and the vehicle is via the pilot line, so whatever is controlling the pilot line on the vehicle side, that's how it works. Okay, so you said to get a more accurate voltage, put a capacitor in parallel? Okay, thanks, we'll keep that in mind. Gentlemen. We did not.
Just curious.
No. Yes.
Do you think the information you're capturing that lets you fix other people and stuff is a little different if you're using different type of transportation? Like, would each fingerprint look different on the transportation or the person?
Right. So the question was, would the fingerprint look different on different charging stations? I suspect yes. Especially, like, for example, sampling the pilot line voltage, we have another divider on the charging station side that we're using to sample. So that's something that would be interesting to explore, is between our charging stations, what is the variation in the parameters that I'm measuring? I expect it would be different. So, yes. So the question was, it's a concern that I wasn't able to synchronize the logs between components. So why wasn't I able to do that? Did I figure it out? Was that basically it? So as best as we could tell, the components reported their logs at different intervals and potentially with different priorities. They all go through a single board that sends all of the data back to the server. So it's possible that some logs were getting delayed while others were reported. I forget the rest of the question, I'm sorry.
Well, are they marked with a timestamp when they get sent?
Yes, everything is marked with a timestamp. And when I was putting together state information with power information just to be able to get all of the parameters for one charge event associated, I did that manually, and if I wasn't sure, I discarded the data. If that's helpful. Okay. Are there any other? Oh, sorry.
Have you ever seen issues with EVs only breaking? Because I know, for instance, a lot of dock charging stations have a max output of 30 amps or something like that. And I think Tesla.
I don't think so. I'm not quite sure I quite understand the question. So you're asking about vehicles bricking a charging station?
Yeah, just by expecting too much light.
I see. So the vehicle tried to draw more current than the charging station could provide. Okay. I have not seen that in our testing. Our charging stations are rated for higher power than any of the vehicles themselves are capable of drawing, at least the ones that I tested. So, yeah. Yes.
Thank you.